Today we'll be discussing my favorite book, Moby Dick. I will go into the specific reasons why I love the book, and I will pull passages from the book that sort of best emulate those specific reasons that I will give. And hopefully by the end of it, I will have made a good case for you to read it if you have not read it yet. So to give you a little background about my history with Moby Dick, I had bought this specific copy, oh god, I think it was almost a year and a half ago, and it's been sitting on my shelf ever since then. And at the turn of the new year, in January, I decided it was due time. I've been staring at it for, you know, a year and a half, and I began to feel guilty. And so I was like, all right, let's check this thing out. Apparently it's the greatest American novel of all time. Apparently it's about whales. There's a lot of whale facts. I guess I'll check it out. Little did I know that it would turn out to be my favorite book. I was not expecting this. It was probably the last thing I expected. I was actually expecting to not like the book going in, but here we are. So in Moby Dick, we follow the story of a common sailor called Ishmael. He is the narrator of the story, and he addresses you directly right from the get-go. And I will read the first paragraph from the book. Call me Ishmael. Some years ago, never mind how long precisely, having little or no money in my purse and nothing particular to interest me on shore, I thought I would sail about a little and see the watery part of the world. It is a way I have of driving off the spleen and regulating the circulation. Whenever I find myself growing grim about the mouth, whenever it is a damp, drizzly November in my soul, whenever I find myself involuntarily pausing before coffin warehouses and bringing up the rear of every funeral I meet, and especially whenever my hypos get such an upper hand of me that it requires a strong moral principle to prevent me from deliberately stepping into the street and methodically knocking people's hats off, then I count it high time to get to sea as soon as I can. And that's all it took for me to be hooked. That's just the... What I love about that paragraph is it's almost in a way kind of confrontational, where it's very personal, where it's Ishmael addressing you, you know, call me Ishmael. And then he gives you the reasoning. What led me to the ocean? Why do I go to the ocean? And that last sentence that he gives, I count it high time to get to sea as soon as I can. And I love that line because I've spent most of my life growing up around the ocean, and I just love being near the ocean. And I, you know, being near the ocean after being away for a long time, there's this sort of cleansing nature to it, I guess you could say, where, you know, you can just breathe in the ocean air and really relax. And so when Ishmael talks about the being drawn towards the sea, it's just something that I could definitely relate to. And I was in at this moment. Right from the get-go, I was in. So when we first meet Ishmael, he is in New Bedford, Massachusetts, and he seeks to come aboard a whaling vessel and enlist as a sailor and hunt whales on the ocean for a few years. That's basically what his goal is. And to do that, he needs to get to Nantucket, and currently he's in New Bedford. So he spends a night at an inn, and he befriends a Pacific Islander named Queequeg. And they become really close friends really quickly, and they eventually make their way to Nantucket, and they enlist on a ship called the Pequot. The captain of this ship is the ever so famous Ahab. Whether or not you've read Moby Dick, you probably know of Captain Ahab. He's one of the most famous characters in all of literature. Unbeknownst to the crew, Captain Ahab is not interested in doing a successful whaling voyage. He is out for revenge. And it is revealed once the sight of land has disappeared and they are out on the open ocean, Captain Ahab informs the crew that this will not be a traditional whaling voyage. Ahab seeks the white whale, Moby Dick. Now, why does he seek this specific whale? Well, Ahab, on a previous voyage, had encountered a white sperm whale of monstrous size, and this whale had ripped his leg off. And so Ahab is a one-legged captain lecturing his crew about how we need to find a one specific whale and we have to scour all the oceans of the earth to find him. And so that's the story. That is Moby Dick. One man's excessive hatred for an animal. If you were to boil it down to its bare essentials, that's what the plot of this book is. However, this book is so much more than its plot. This book, it's so hard. You don't even know where to begin when talking about Moby Dick because it touches on so many different aspects of life and literature. And it's just, for me, it's my desert island book. I think you could read Moby Dick many times over and still find a plethora of new things springing out of the text each time. In telling the story of Moby Dick, Herman Melville draws on so many aspects of life to tell the story, to flesh out the story, and take you on this journey with Ishmael as Ahab takes him on the hunt for the white whale. So, for example, Melville draws on Greek and Roman mythology, astronomy, economics, all these different aspects he uses to tell the story. And I cannot speak, and rather than telling you about it, I'd rather just read to you directly from the text specific passages that I think best emulate what I'm trying to say. Why did the old Persians hold the sea holy? Why did the Greeks give it a separate deity and own brother of Jove? Surely all this is not without meaning, and still deeper the meaning of that story of Narcissus, who, because he could not grasp the tormenting, mild image he saw in the fountain, plunged into it and was drowned. But that same image we ourselves see in all rivers and oceans. It is the image of the ungraspable phantom of life, and this is the key to it all. It is evident quite early on in the book that Melville knows a thing or two. He's obviously spent quite an amount of time studying great works of the past and using that in his book to tell the story. And so because of this, you will have to, the book is going to make you work because there's so many references that you couldn't possibly know all of them by yourself. So you're going to have to refer to the end notes many, many times, but I assure you, it is worth it. It is so, so worth it. In telling the story, Ishmael also humors the reader in the ways that he introduces characters into the story. One of my favorite chapters in the book is titled Knights and Squires. When Ishmael has boarded the Pequod and they've set sail, he introduces us to the different ranks of crew members aboard the Pequod. The third mate was Flask, a native of Tisbury in Martha's Vineyard. A short, stout, ruddy young fellow, very pugnacious concerning whales, who somehow seemed to think that the great leviathans had personally and hereditarily affronted him, and therefore it was a sort of point of honor with him to destroy them whenever encountered. So utterly lost was he to all sense of reverence for the many marvels of their majestic bulk and mystic ways, and so dead to anything like an apprehension of any possible danger from encountering them, that in his poor opinion, the wondrous whale was but a species of magnified mouse, or at least water rat, requiring only a little circumvention and some small application of time and trouble in order to kill and boil. And so that paragraph, that character introduction that I just read you, is it's an example of one of the many passages in this book that on my first read through, I would read something like the one I just read you, and I would just slap my forehead. I'd be like, oh my God, the writing is just so brilliant. So brilliant. And I would like go back to the top of the paragraph and I'd read it again. I'd read it like two or three times just to savor the paragraph. And then it would only, after two or three times, I'd feel satisfied enough to continue reading. But just paragraphs like that I just love it. There's humor in it, but it's also, Ishmael is reflecting on how mankind has lost reverence for nature, or at least in the character of Flask, he has lost the awe that the whales of the ocean deserve. Some of the critiques that I've seen regarding Moby Dick is that there is complaints when Ishmael ventures outside of the central narrative to talk about whale facts and ship facts, and just totally venture outside the story and even for several chapters in a row, just talk about stuff that seems to be inconsequential to the plot. So for example, I'm going to list some chapter names that deal specifically with whale facts, I guess you could say, chapters that are in regards to whales and not at all with the story or what the plot is, what's happening with the plot, basically. Chapter 15 is called Of the Monstrous Pictures of Whales. Chapter 16 is called Of the Less Erroneous Pictures of Whales and the True Pictures of Whaling Scenes. Chapter 17 is Of Whales in Paint, in Teeth, in Wood, in Sheet Iron, in Stone, in Mountains, in Stars. And that's one of my favorite chapters because what Ishmael does is he reflects on the depiction of the whale in all these different mediums, in teeth, and wood, and sheet iron, and stone, and mountains, and reflects on what could that possibly mean. But I'll get more into why I love those chapters in a bit. Another one is titled The Sperm Whale's Head, Contrasted View. Another one right after, The Right Whale's Head, Contrasted View. And then another one is The Whale as a Dish, where Ishmael reflects on how you would go about cooking a whale and eating it. In terms of the so-called ship facts chapters, you'll see such chapter titles as The Masthead, The Cabin Table, and The Quarterdeck. Now, again, this was something that I was wary of going into the book and something that I feared I wasn't going to like. These so-called boring chapters where Herman Melville seems to ramble on and on about stuff that has nothing to do with the plot. And turns out those chapters are some of my favorite in the book. I don't want to say something cliche like it's not about the destination, it's about the journey or whatever. But I feel like it's very applicable in this case because the destination is we need to find Moby Dick. But along the way, Ishmael, in reflecting on the whale, reflecting on the aspects of the ship, as well as many other things, he just reflects upon life and has this sort of disconnected view of mankind and reality and has these brilliant reflections that are just so interesting to read and listening to, because Ishmael is addressing you. He's the narrator right from the get-go. Call me Ishmael. That's the first line in the book. He's talking to you. And I'm going to give a specific example of an extract from one of these chapters, which if it weren't for these chapters, we wouldn't get statements like the one that I'm about to read you. And in this chapter titled The Masthead, where the chapter is literally just about the masthead of a ship, you know, the crow's nest is on, basically. And Ishmael writes about being on, you know, at the top of the masthead and looking out on the ocean. There you stand, 100 feet above the silent decks, striding along the deep as if the masts were gigantic stilts, while beneath you and between your legs, as it were, swim the hugest monsters of the sea, even as ships once sailed between the boots of the famous Colossus at Old Rhodes. There you stand, lost in the infinite series of the sea with nothing ruffled but the waves. The tranced ship indolently rolls, the drowsy trade winds blow, everything resolves you into languor. Another example of this is in the chapter titled The Tale, where Ishmael speaks strictly on the tale of the whale, the fluke. And in this chapter, Ishmael writes, I once saw a large herd of whales in the east, all heading towards the sun, and for a moment vibrating in concert with peaked flukes. As it seemed to me at the time, such a grand embodiment of adoration of the gods was never beheld, even in Persia, the home of the fire worshippers. As Ptolemy Philopater testified of the African elephant, I then testified of the whale, pronouncing him the most devout of all beings. I mean, it's statements like that throughout this book that make it almost a religious experience, where the whale is this sort of divine and sacred object. And I want to reiterate that we wouldn't get statements like these without these digressions by Ishmael. These chapters which venture outside the plot, and though they, you know, have nothing to add to the plot, it's not about that. It's about Ishmael's journey and the journey he takes you on. At least that's how I interpret it. I'm sure there may be people who disagree with me, but that's what my interpretation is. What I love about this book is at several instances throughout the story, Ishmael reminds us of the beautiful horror of the ocean, the tranquil surface and the horrors that lie below. And I think this is best emulated in the paragraph, "Hither and thither on high glided the snow-white wings of small, unspeckled birds. These were the gentle thoughts of the feminine air, but to and fro in the deeps, far down in the bottomless blue, rushed mighty leviathans, swordfish, and sharks, and these were the strong, troubled, murderous thinkings of the masculine sea." What I love about this paragraph, and there's multiple reasons, but for one, it evokes such strong imagery. I see a camera, you know, pointed up towards the birds as they're flying in the blue sky, and then the camera just plunges into the depths, and we see, you know, the monster sharks and swordfish and leviathans, as the book says, and it's terrifying, but it's also beautiful in a kind of, in a certain way, just the tranquil above and the horror below. I can't think of a better paragraph that best emulates that feeling, that sort of primal fear that one feels when out on the open ocean. What I also love is the use of the word rushed in this context. When he says rushed, so I'll read it again. "Far down in the bottomless blue rushed mighty leviathans." And the word rushed, it evokes that primal fear. When I think rushed, I think I'm the target and some monstrous sea creature is coming to get me. You know, it's just, it's horrifying. It's a biblical feeling, I guess. You know, the story of Jonah and the whale. I feel like a sea monster is going to get me. It just shows, and this happens several times throughout the books where Ishmael reminds you, you know, there's darkness within, and it's just immaculate. I can't put it into words. Just the feelings that the text evokes it's primal. That's the best way I can say it. It's primal. The fear. And so now I want to talk about Ahab and why I love Ahab, the character. Melville was a big fan of Shakespeare, and if I'm not wrong, I believe he referred to him as Saint William at one point, because to Melville, you know, Shakespeare was the best writer and in a sense was a god to Melville. That reverence towards Shakespeare, Melville shows in the character of Ahab. Ahab speaks in almost primarily Shakespearean-esque dialogue. And reflect again on Ahab's position. He has had his leg ripped off by this angry, monstrous whale. And though not explicitly stated, the book implies that the whale could have taken off more than just the leg. So interpolate from that what you will. But you have to hold an awe, like Ahab's hatred that he holds for this creature of the earth. And what could cause a man to hold such hatred for, as in sort of Ishmael's view, is a divine being. And so I've found a specific paragraph or lines of dialogue that I think best encapsulate who Ahab is. And again, I'm pulling this from a broader dialogue. I've honed in on a few lines here, but the essence of what I'm trying to say is there, in which Ahab says, "Fool, I am the Fates' lieutenant. I act under orders. Look thou, underling, that thou obeyest mine. Stand round me, men. Ye see an old man cut down to the stump, leaning on a shivered lance, propped up on a lonely foot." So there's this paragraph that I've chosen, this lines of dialogue that I've chosen, highlights these two aspects of Ahab, where one, he is driven by revenge and anger, and nothing will stop him. Moby Dick himself is a force of nature, but in a way also is Ahab. And again, you get that reminder of Ahab's anger towards his situation, the reminder that I'm literally sitting on a peg leg. This creature has wronged me, and I must fix that. And so this will culminate into what is my favorite instance the right word, of dialogue that I've ever read in anything ever. This is just these favorite lines of dialogue. And again, it's Shakespearean. It is biblical. It is It is incredible. And in this part of the text, Ahab challenges Moby Dick in this Shakespearean style, in which he says, "Towards thee I roll, thou all-destroying but unconquering whale. To the last I grapple with thee. From hell's heart I stab at thee. For hate's sake I spit my last breath at thee." I mean, it doesn't get better than that. It doesn't get better than that. I can't... Just the culmination to that moment, and I'm speechless, basically. When I read that the first time, I'm speechless. When I read it for the 100th time, like I just did, I'm speechless. It is just so incredible. And as a newfounded fan of Shakespeare, my love is only multiplied with each passing day. It's just, again, the Shakespearean aspect to it. And I'll leave it at that. I think I've made my point of why I love this book, and hopefully I was convincing in, you know, making you consider reading it at some point. And I want to highlight at the end here that this book is so many things. It touches on so many different things, as I've said. I probably sound like a broken record at this point, but I could probably talk about this book for hours on end. But for your sake, I'll spare you. I will cut myself off now and just say, this is my favorite book, and I think you should read it. It's fantastic. And for those who say that it's the greatest American novel, I can't help but agree with them. So thank you all for watching. I know I got a little excited in today's video with all those readings and whatnot, but yeah. That's it for today's video. I hope to have another one out soon by the end of the week, and keep your eyes peeled for that. Thanks for watching.